Daniel will be titled, Daniel's presentation is The Cognitive Mechanics of Creativity.
All right. My name is Daniel Dalek. I'm very grateful to be here. I'm also very grateful to dedicate this talk to a dear friend that passed just a couple of weeks ago. His name is Michael Perkins. He's a very creative soul. I just want to throw that out there. But let's get going. So the reason, or actually I should put this, I never thought that I would be here in the first place, much less want to be here, like a UC Berkeley a talk, something that's outside of your normal academics. And it wasn't until something really sparked my interest, which was racing go-karts. So I'm gonna use that throughout the talk as an example with creativity, because that's what really taught me that we're all fundamentally craving to be creative. It's something that every one of us have in common. So in my search for this, I started broad, and I took it back in time. What I did was, I saw that there was an Eastern Hemisphere outlook on creativity and then a Western Hemisphere outlook. They split. So, in the Eastern Hemisphere, because religious, they were both actually affiliated with the divine. So they both believed that creativity wasn't originating from any sort of personal attribute, but more of the actual religious affiliation with something greater than us. So on the Eastern Hemisphere, we saw that religion was more of a mythic tradition. It was nature comes in and out of existence. There wasn't, there was like changing shapes, more along the theory of conservation, you know? That made novelty and newness not very important. It was more of a momentary reaction, something very similar to a deja vu. On the Western Hemisphere, it was more along the lines of, because religious affiliations were that God created the universe from nothing, the concept of creating something physical is really important. The concept of novelty is also really important. So as far as this pyramid goes, I'm gonna try to explain the difference between the mythic, which was the Eastern Hemisphere, which they resided more on an intuitive level of creative thought, versus the Western Hemisphere, which they reside more on a logical creative thought. So, without getting too wrapped up in it, the first stage of this pyramid is known as the raw data phase. It's when you look at something, for example, a tree. I look at it, I don't know that it's called a tree yet, I just look at it that it exists. It's in the moment, it's as soon at first glance. The nominal stage is where I start to name it. And it is not until the third stage that more and more information from my past knowledge comes and it takes me into the abstract thought of what a tree might be, how old it is, the colors of the leaves, whatever it is. So what we see here is that this, the intuitive, is more along the momentary. Like I said with the deja vu, it's super hard to explain and reproduce. So because of that, it kind of stayed in the moment, and it wasn't something that we analyzed any further. But in the West, because it was more of a logical tradition, it was something that allowed us to explain and reproduce our findings, like the scientific method, or even like a drawing. It can be explained what goes on in here, how it makes you feel. The deja vu, not so much. There's only a few words that we know about that. So what happens then, with this explaining and reproducing, it allows us to analyze creativity, which in the West, because our industrialized view of creativity derived from the West, because the mythic kind of went obsolete, we actually broke the whole entire process up into five stages. We call it the creative process. In stage one, the preparation stage is something where you gain all your knowledge, all your experience. For me and my racing, it was the seat time, it was the experience on the track, being familiar with the track, even walking the track helped. Then to let that incubate in my mind in stage two, where my brain rehearses it, it allows my then previous knowledge to associate with one another, which we'll get into in a minute, and there's an insight that happens. So in this incubation chamber, incubation stage, it kind of just sits. And then in the insight, there's a spark that comes. But that is not creativity itself. Creativity is the transition from the mental to the physical, when you're actually creating something. And that, the physical could be a product, it could be an action that I've done, it can be, for example, in my case, the fastest way to go through a turn in racing. And that creation allows me then, because I produced it, to evaluate it. When I evaluate it, I can see what domain it qualifies as creative. For example, a third grade classroom, a drawing of a T-Rex with arms long enough to hug the teacher might be creative to me, but it's not as creative as the theory of relativity in the same domain. So we see that creativity is very domain specific. And it's very hard to then study biologically in each of our brains, because in order to study it, we have to operationalize it. We have to define it so we know we're studying. So in order to do that, what I pulled from The Neuroscience of Creativity, which is a wonderful book published by the MIT Press on this field of creativity, they said that to pull out of memory something new and appropriate that was never stored there in the first place is the magic of creativity. It's what every single time you're creative, everybody kind of has in common. So that allowed us to go a little bit deeper into what actually happens from the broadest sense, like we talked about with the Eastern and Western Hemisphere, to what happens in every single one of our brains. So part of the logical view of creativity, a subset of it, the simplest version of the creative process, is something called combinational creativity, where, like the name says, it's the combining of two concepts together, two familiar concepts that you know, and it creates a new novel concept. So something that we all know is the phone wall case, but it started off as two concepts. So as you can see here, let's let experience one be the concept of the phone, and experience two be the concept of the wallet. That allows it to breach into our consciousness that we can actually relate the two in an associative state. Usually this state's known as mind wandering, when our eyes kind of unfocus and we kind of get into our brain, whatever it might be. We get this state of insight, oh, I know that I can make this happen. But in this analytic state, that's when we bring all of our past knowledge onto this new concept that we want to evolve. And with this, we analyze, how can I make this happen? What can I put on it to make it creative and really useful in my domain that I want to use it for? So then, after these two states, we get the creative experience. Now, this is kind of what the mind does, but it also goes a little bit deeper, and we can see this in the brain. But first, let me show you a real-life example kind of my experience with racing. What I saw whenever I was kind of hungry to really go fast, to really learn how to go fast. I had my experience, but I needed to learn more. Everybody wanted that creative spark. So whenever I focused on someone that might go fast, that might know how to go fast, his speed was relevant to me because it could make me learn, make me better. That relevance, I wouldn't necessarily see with someone that wasn't as fast. That was kind of harder to see that speed. But things became more of a cost-benefit analysis. The person that wasn't as fast, there was more cost, versus the person that was fast, there was more benefit to me and less cost. With that cost-benefit analysis, which every single time you look at something, how does it relate to me? I relate the cost and the benefit, everybody goes through this. With that comes the ability to then relate the familiar novel or the familiar concept that we know of to this novel, new, unfamiliar thing that we're trying to learn. In my case, it's studying the other person that I'm seeing is really fast. So with that, what happens is that when we relate that familiar knowledge to what we're about to learn, the stuff that we're about to learn actually gets encoded into our brain at the precise location where the rest of the familiar stuff is. And then when the association comes together, of, like for example, the phone and the wallet, they're probably pretty close together, because for me at least, I only carry three things: my keys, my phone, and my wallet. To have it be two things is really much easier, and they're located in the actual same park. So then what happens is they can bridge together once you make that connection. So like mental, like physical. In the brain, they bridge together. And the more distant they are apart when they bridge, the more transformative it can be. So for example, let this red arrow right there, that neuron, and by the way, this is a picture, but it is literally, I mean, it literally kind of looks like this in your brain. Let that neuron be my experience for driving on really hot, sticky tracks where the grip, there's so much that whenever you turn, it can actually throw you out of the cart. Let this blue arrow represent the experience that I have driving on cold, slick tracks where there's less G-force. There's a lot of difference in how I set up the go-kart and how I drive to the point where they are worthy of not sharing everything, where they're just far enough apart, but because they're both in go-karts, they both share the general concept of four wheels, there's a gas, there's a brake, there's a turning capabilities. That allows them to share a lot of information. Now, a little bit different. I also got a chance to race formula cars. In formula cars, which is kind of a mix between a go-kart and a car, it is similar enough in the concept where there's four wheels and a gas and a brake, but it's different because of the weight, to the reaction time, all that stuff. That in the brain, even though they're not completely connected, they are connected in different ways because I use similar driving styles throughout it. Let this, the orange circle, represent everything on two wheels. After I stopped racing competitively, I partook in dirt biking. And dirt biking was awesome because instead of leaning outside of the turn when you're going into a turn with go-karts to weigh all that weight on the rear or on the side to corner you through the turn, you're now leaning into the turn with a motorcycle. So very similar concepts in the way where there's a gas, there's a brake, and there's turning capability, but it's different enough so that your driving styles, your riding styles change. Now, if I wanted to create a go-kart mixed with a formula car, that could be pretty transformative, but not as transformative if I wanted to create a dirt bike mixed with a go-kart. That's going to be way more transformative. So, how do we get those transformations? How do we facilitate it to possibly intentionally create something? Because usually creativity is more in the back of our minds. We cannot control it, but we can facilitate it with our actions. One thing is, we have to experience something new. Our risk has to increase, our limits must go down. I had to try the fastest way through the turn, even though it might be scary, in order to learn that it was the fastest way and that I can associate more things to that in the future. Which gets me to my next point. The more detail-oriented we are, because our brain stores it in the same spot of the same detail that we're getting, the more detail we can be aware of in the environment, the more possible relevance we see later on in the future. With that, it allows us to then relate all this detail that we know to this novel detail that we're about to learn. If I never paid attention to this way of doing something, then I might not get that connection later on in life. So there's three things that I'm leaving you with. One of them is to take risks, is to try something new. The second is to be aware, very detail-oriented, so that then you can relate more things in the future. And the third is this. Every single time you see something creative, whether you saw something creative today or not, it means that you are creative because you have accessed something, a deeper version or a deeper level of thought that people used to think was divine. You have accessed this, and you yourself are creative. Whether it be the same thought that the person intended you to think, or a different thought that you came up with. You are creative. So be proud of that. And congratulations to that. Thank you.